Hello, folks. Al Frost here at United Methodist Church in Charlevoix. Tonight we have Bishop Tom Gummelton from Detroit giving a wonderful speech on making peace in a hostile world.
I'm very pleased to be able to be here tonight to speak on the subject of making peace in a hostile world.
My name is Tim Boyko. I'm a resident of Charlevoix County. But I don't think we should lose Christ's message of peace at any time.
And loving your neighbor, right?
We need...
And your enemy.
Yeah, we need warriors like this to carry on. So, thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Yeah, the message is love your neighbor and love your enemy as yourself. And thank you very much. Al Frost, I want to welcome you to gathering and share United Methodist Church in Charlevoix. Elizabeth Humphreys, former Rutherford High School teacher in Detroit, and actually same high school I was at.
Organist, there was a church over here.
World-class musician.
Well, I think it's an honor to have Bishop Gummelton come to Northern Michigan. He is the quintessential peace advocate.
Please sit back, enjoy the program, and share it with your children, and pass the wonderful wisdom on. Thank you.
In the Catholic Church, starting about 40 years ago now, we have celebrated on January 1st each year what we call the World Day of Prayer for Peace. And each year, the Bishop of Rome writes a statement to give set kind of a theme for that day of prayer. And John Paul II wrote one for January 1st, 2002. Which I think is a perfect framework for what we are talking about tonight. How to make peace in a hostile world. How to move from violence to peace. January 1st, 2002, of course, was a couple of months after 9/11, 2001. So it's in that context that John Paul wrote this particular Peace Day statement. And in it, he asks a question, which is the question that we are challenging ourselves with tonight. He says, in a world in which the power of evil seems once again to have taken the upper hand, and he's thinking about 9/11, how will that world be transformed into a world in which the noblest aspirations of the human heart will triumph, a world in which peace will prevail. So we're in a world where, as he puts it, the power of evil seems to have the upper hand. You can have terrorist attacks like we had on September 11th, 2001. That happens in a world where the power of evil seems to have the upper hand. Or you can look around the world and see the violence and the killing that's going on in so many different places. How can we transform that into a world where peace will prevail? And that's the question we're challenging ourselves with tonight. And John Paul says, recent events, he says, including the terrible killings just mentioned, and he had talked about what happened here in 9/11. He says, those events move me to return to a theme which often stirs in the depth of my heart. When I remember the events of history which have marked my life, especially my youth. And you may remember, John Paul was a Polish pope, as we called him. He had grown up in Poland during the time of the Nazi tyranny, and then subsequently 40 years of communist tyranny. And so he grew up when those terrible events were happening. And he says, the enormous suffering of peoples and individuals, even among my own friends and acquaintances, caused by Nazi and communist totalitarianism has never been far from my thoughts and prayers. I have often paused to reflect on the persistent question, how do we restore the moral and social order subjected to such horrific violence. How do we restore the moral order, make peace happen in the midst of such horrific violence? My reasoned conviction, confirmed in turn by biblical revelation. So he's thought about this, he's prayed about this, and he's reflected on God's word. And so then he says, my conviction is that the shattered moral order cannot be fully restored except by a response that combines justice with forgiveness. The pillars of true peace are justice and that form of love which is forgiveness, enemy love. Those are the two pillars upon which we can and must build peace in the world. A pillar of justice, and then that pillar of forgiveness or active love, enemy love. The most challenging thing probably that Jesus ever taught, colonial possession in one of the most brutally efficient slave colonies ever. It was a very fertile area. It was taken over by France from the Spaniards who had first colonized the whole island. But after a war, France settled with Spain by taking over that part of the island, which then became Haiti, was under French colonial rule. Haitians are still living with the legacy of the slave trade and the revolt that finally removed the French. The revolt began in 1791. More than a decade of war followed. France's largest expeditionary force, led by General Leclerc, Napoleon's brother-in-law, Napoleon was the Emperor of France at the time, was sent to put down the rebellion. As the French operation flagged, the slave general Toussaint Louverture was invited to a party. They were going to settle with the rebels. Toussaint died of exposure and tuberculosis in 1803. Every Haitian schoolchild knows his last words by heart. Here they are. In overthrowing me, you have cut down in San Domingo, as Haiti was then called, only the trunk of the tree of black liberty. It will spring up again by the roots, for they are numerous and deep. And in fact, then in November 1803, the former slaves won what proved to be the war's final battle, and on January 1st, 1804, declared the Independent Republic of Haiti. It was Latin America's first independent country, the only nation ever born of a slave revolt. The Haitian Revolution was a dramatic challenge to the world as it then was. Slavery was at the heart of the thriving system of merchant capitalism that was profiting Europe, devastating Africa, and propelling the rapid expansion of the Americas. The slave trade was behind the expansion of in our own country, the prosperity of the of Hispaniola in the Caribbean, and throughout the world. The slave revolution became a challenge to the world as it then was. But virtually all the world's powers sided with France against the self-proclaimed Black Republic. See, our own nation, which had won its independence from a colonial power only less than 20 years before, in 1776, we fought our civil war of independence, and it was over about 1781. We won our independence. And then 20 years later, when the Haitians did it, we refused to recognize that country. And of course, the reason was we were afraid there could be a slave revolt in our country. And so we refused to recognize this country as a sovereign nation, declaring its independence as we did.